Declare war on your enemies, the polarity strategy. To start combat, you must know and identify your opponents. It is critical to see who, what you are fighting, and the reasons behind your battle. You need clarity and cannot allow yourself to be blinded by the fog of war. Here, green differentiates between the inner enemy and the outer enemy. In 401 BC, Xenophon was hired by Cyrus, whose mission was to overthrow his brother and Persian king Artaxerxes. Xenophon had to shift a mercenary band of Greeks into a concentrated force, fighting for self-preservation. They had to identify their opponent, conclude the reasons for their bloodshed, and resolve their own disputes. There is an old African-American proverb that perfectly describes this. If there is no enemy within, the enemy outside can do us no harm. In this historical example, the real threat came from the Greeks' own ranks, not from the outside. Oftentimes, we find ourselves in a predicament that was not of our own choosing. It was not our fault. On a side note, it is advantageous to always assume you're at fault. Take full ownership, put the burden of responsibility on your shoulders, and grow with it. Continuing, it was not our fault, and we have a right to be angry. But what happens then is essential. Are we going to sit around, complain, argue, and moan in defiance? Or are we going to accept the situation we found ourselves in and look for a way out? Xenophon was more of a philosopher and historian than a mercenary. So he understood the problem at hand was not that the Greeks were few in numbers, surrounded by a vast army of Persians far away from home. That was secondary. The enemy within was that the mercenaries were lost, unable to help themselves in a never-ending cycle of bargaining and debate in the belly of the beast that was Artaxerxes' lands, the outer enemy. Xenophon knew they had to be consumed with one idea, and one idea only, survival. As they focused on getting home alive as a concentrated force, they became inventive and inspired. This is what I call forced creativity. When you have no other option, magically, you start seeing solutions that weren't there before. Necessity rules the world. The Greeks had to come up with a plan because their very lives depended on their doing so. But the most important thing was this. They had to understand what was at stake. The mission and the possible consequences had to be crystal perfectly clear. What are they fighting and why are they fighting it? This is the polarity strategy, dispelling of the blinding fog of war. You need clarity. Once they realized that, they declared total war. No middle ground, no half measures, no prisoners, only the mission at hand and the will to survive. That is, in fact, the death ground strategy. We will be looking at that in chapter 4. I'm so pumped for that episode, you cannot miss it. And again, if there is no enemy within, the enemy outside can do us no harm. It took them several years, but the vast majority of the Greek mercenaries, along with Xenophon, had made it back to Greece safely. Now, I don't know about you, but to me, that's a very inspiring story. The outer enemy. Margaret Thatcher did not hold back with clarity on who her outer opponents were. She took a strong stance and fought relentlessly for what she felt was the right thing, not ever giving up on herself, while facing her opposition, thus fulfilling her tasks. This might as well just be about Donald Trump. Look out for the similarities. Margaret was a middle-class woman and resembled a housewife more than a politician. But it was her instinct to stand out, to unapologetically be herself. Instead of becoming a replaceable insider, she stayed an outsider to politics, taking unconventional approaches, caring more about her conviction than being liked. Popularity is ephemeral and superficial. Margaret Thatcher defined her enemies, the socialists, the Soviets, and the Argentinians. She understood having a strong stance would make some of the public hate her. You can't please everyone. But she also knew it would signify her courage, determination, self-sacrifice, and power. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is one of the reasons why Trump is such an interesting character. If only his opponents had subscribed to my channel, or perhaps read Green's books. Now, I want to make this clear, I'm neither for or against Trump. I live in Switzerland, I could care less, and I'm not taking a political stance, but the fact that even I, an ignorant 22-year-old, far away from US soil, know who he is and what he stands for, the fact that the media is constantly being outraged by him, not taking their cameras off him for 1 second, Some of you might remember Law Number 6, court detention at all cost. You shouldn't underestimate Trump and his unique hairstyle. I just decided this instance to review his book, The Art of the Deal. I bet it's full of wisdom that we're all on about on this channel. Like him or hate him, you can learn from him. While researching, I stumbled upon one of Margaret's quotes. In politics, if you want anything said, ask a man. If you want anything done, ask a woman. So I'm not entirely sure how much credit we can give her now. I'm joking, of course. It looks a lot like Hillary might be the next president. But judging from their campaigns so far, maybe Trump is the one to get things done. Then again, what do I know? I'm always glad to be proven wrong in the comment section. Who is winning the election? Keys to warfare. What are the most important lessons we should take away from this chapter? Define your opponent. Know who and what you're fighting. Understand why you're fighting your adversary. If you don't know what the problem is, you can't solve it. If you don't know who's causing the problems, they'll keep causing them. Define your opponent. It is that important. There's a good reason why Green starts this book with the polarity strategy. The most powerful strike doesn't mean anything if you don't know what to hit with it. This is step one in every war. Know your enemy. Whether we're talking about actual warfare, business endeavors, relationships, whatever. These principles are universal. In uncertainty, test to ensure you've defined the right opponent. Never trust appearances. Just like the Godfather, Don Vito Corleone, you might initially think the Tattaglia family is the real enemy, only to discover the attached strings that are in the hands of Barzini. In other words, make sure you're right about your target and you haven't been misled to direct your attack at a pawn or a decoy. Distract attention away from you by using your opponents. When your opposition attacks, they will go for your weaknesses, the things that make you stand out as an individual character. Instead of justifying yourself, own your image. Margaret was a middle-class housewife turned politician. Indeed, she was unconventional and aggressive, yes, but she stood up for herself and regarded those points as her qualities. Then she pointed out the faults and the evil of her rivals, as their image was built around pleasing everyone. That was an easy attack. You roast Donald Trump because of his hair, he laughs it off. You tried to battle rap B-Rabbit / Eminem in 8 Mile. He proudly owns up to all his shortcomings and shreds his opponents to pieces lyrically. Reversal. Do all of this, but in victory, act conciliatory. Be humble once you've defeated your opponent. You do not want to rub salt in the wound of your enemy after you've won. The victory is yours, you've got what you wanted, now be modest. If you take on the traits of a dreadful winner instead, like a Calvin Candy type in Quentin Tarantino's Django, chances are you might be dealing with a Mr. Schultz, who, offended in his honor, won't take kindly to your actions. Like the UFC fighter Conor McGregor, do anything to win. Declare mental warfare. Get into the head of your opponent. Make them so emotionally invested that you start to consume them, like we've seen with Jose Aldo. Again, being liked by all, being popular is ephemeral and superficial. Let some of the public hate you. It's better to stand out. It's better to have a strong set of values. It's better to win. And then, when the time for the physical fight finally arrives, it might be over within 13 seconds. The psychological war was already won before the cage fight had even begun. But once Conor was declared the winner, all his nasty behavior, all the disrespect towards Aldo was gone, and he embraced his victory with modesty. Aldo clearly was the outer enemy, but let me quote Conor on the inner enemy. I see this a lot with people, and they're so insecure about some bullshit ideas that the successful are born talented, and they're just cut from a different cloth. These guys come up with every excuse in the book for why they're not enough, and McGregor just nailed it. There's no talent here. This is hard work. This is an obsession. Talent does not exist. We are all equals as human beings. You could be anyone if you put in the time. You will reach the top and that's that. I am not talented. I am obsessed. And I couldn't agree more. To me, talent is just a word you use to compliment someone else. When I hear you're talented, I thank them and go about my day knowing fully well I'm not a special snowflake. And regardless of what they believe in my mind, they were just being nice to me, and that's it. I continue improving myself as the work in progress we all are. For lots of people, what's holding them back is themselves. You're fighting the world just as much as you're fighting yourself, your own negative thoughts, emotions, and gravitation to comfort. That is it for this chapter. However, I deliberately left one part of the first historical example untouched because it was non-essential to the polarity strategy. But just really quickly, let me read you this excerpt from Anabasis, The March Up Country, written by Xenophon himself. Then Xenophon got up and first called together the under officers of Proxenos. When they were collected, he said, "Gentlemen, I cannot sleep, and I don't think you can. And I can't lie here when I see what a plight we are in. It is clear that the enemy did not show us open war until they thought they had everything well prepared. And no one among us takes the pains to make the best possible resistance. Until they thought they had everything well prepared. And no one among us takes the pains to make the best possible resistance." Does that sound familiar? Does it ring any bells? War can never be avoided, only delayed to the advantage of your enemies. That's Machiavelli 101. Yet we have people in charge who do exactly what the Greek mercenaries were doing initially. I refuse to think some of our world leaders don't know any better. And guess what would have happened to these Greek men were it not for Xenophon to lead them? They would have been unapologetically slaughtered. Anyways, I think I will refrain from doing any more political rant slash commentary like this, unless you'd want me to. I just couldn't resist because the times we live in right now are, to put it frankly, utterly insane. But I want to keep the videos as strictly about the book and the vast wealth of knowledge it conveys as I can. Good. If you're not already watching this in the official playlist, then be sure to click this box right here. It will guide you through the strategies in perfect chronological order. No tedious searching for more necessary. As always, thanks for watching. And please forgive me for mispronouncing words and names. This is my 4th out of 6 languages. My accent is one of the things that make me unique. Und das ist gut so. Now, the things I got coming up, I would subscribe if I were you. Nothing else makes sense.